Dear all, welcome to today's lecture on convergent divergent thinking. So design thinking as convergent divergent questioning, what it is we'll see. So we had seen in our previous lecture what is meant by design thinking and what are the different stages that are involved in design thinking. So what is this convergent and divergent questioning? We start with divergent thinking in design. So divergence means we are diverging or expanding towards a point. That is the meaning of diverging. So in thinking, we say that divergent thinking is a process of finding out or generating a large number of ideas for a particular problem. Suppose we have a problem statement and many of the design team members sit together and they generate a large number of ideas, and these ideas are collected together without checking whether all these ideas are workable or not. So we don't check whether they are workable or not. We try to collect as many ideas as possible for the given problem statement. So such a process is known as divergent thinking. So divergent thinking can be defined as the process of finding out a large number of solutions for a problem statement. And it is actually a thought process of generating creative solutions. So usually brainstorming process is one of the methods of generating a large number of solutions to a particular problem. So it can be said that brainstorming is a process involved in divergent thinking. Now there are certain features of divergent thinking that you should understand. First, it is a free flowing chain of ideas. So divergent thinking, as we mentioned, we start from a problem, a customer's problem, and we generate as many ideas as possible. So we don't check whether these ideas are workable or not. We try to generate maximum number of ideas, and it happens in a non-linear manner. There is no sequence of thinking. So every person who is involved in the thought process is free to think in his own way. He can generate ideas in his own way. There is no defined method or a particular method that the person has to follow. Then multiple ideas can be emerged at the same time. So since we have a large number of members involved in this process, it is possible that many ideas are generated at the same point of time. And it is not mandatory that only one idea comes up at a point of time. Since there are a number of people involved, a large number of ideas will come out at the same time. And it is non-linear in nature. Non-linearity means that multiple solutions are thought of and explored at the same time. And all this happens in a very short period of time. So this process of brainstorming or this thought process is defined for only a very short period of time, where the team members sit together and generate maximum number of ideas for a given problem. So that is that are the different features of divergent thinking. So during this process, unexpected relationships are built between the ideas. Even though a large number of ideas are made, there might be connections between certain ideas. So we can see here the points which we have mentioned just now. We have the divergent thinking that forms the core process, and it enables free flows of ideas, and it is a non-linear thinking process. multiple ideas are generated at the same time, and also unexpected connections are formed between certain ideas. And divergent thinking is actually, or it enhances the creativity of thinkers. So since we start with the problem, we think of a large number of ideas to solve that problem, it will enhance the creativity of all the people involved in that team. And the term divergent thinking was first coined by J.P. Guilford in 1956. We'll see later on about convergent thinking. Convergent thinking was also coined by J.P. Guilford in the same year. And he coined the free association theory of creativity, which says that concepts are connected inside our brains as semantic networks. And psychologists have claimed that the difference in creativity levels of people is dependent on the type of semantic networks of concepts inside the human brain. So what is meant is that there are people with different creativity levels. Each people have their own different creativity level. All the people are not same when we think about their creativity level or the way of thinking. Each person thinks differently. So even if we have a design team, and if suppose there are 10 people who are involved in the design team and they are taking part in the thinking process, then we can see that each person tries to develop a different idea. That is because their thought processes work differently. And there are two different types of thinkers actually, that is mentioned as two connections. Actually, there are two different types of thinkers. One is a flat thinker and another is a steep thinker. So we'll see what are the two different thinkers or two connections that are mentioned here, flat and steep. Now, design thinkers with flat networks are those people with large number of loose conceptual connections. So which means that these people are free thinkers and they are more creative in nature. So these thinkers, they do not follow any logical step, they do not follow any particular procedure, they just think very wildly so that they can generate maximum number of creative ideas. So such type of design thinkers are called flat thinkers or flat networks. Then the people with steep networks, they are more logical, they do a procedural approach, they follow a logical approach because they have linear association between the nodes. So all these nodes, they are something that is connected with the brain. How people think about a particular problem, when they think logically or procedurally, step by step, they keep a connection between the various steps they follow, they are known as logical thinkers. And those people who think very freely without having any connections between each of the stages in which they think, they are known as flat thinkers. So steep networks or people with steep networks, they follow logical steps or procedural step so that they are not much creative. So in divergent thinking, what we need are design thinkers with flat networks, because they'll be able to generate maximum number of free ideas and very creative ideas. So that is what is needed in design. Creative ideas are needed. So in order to generate that, that can be done only with thinkers with flat networks. Now, how to find out such people with flat networks or steep networks? That can be found out only during the idea generation process. So during idea generation, when the ideas generated by a person follows a logical step, then that person is surely having a steep network. And if a person brings out a large number of creative ideas and each ideas are very much different in nature, then such a person can be categorized under flat network. So in divergent thinking, actually it is, or it follows a non-linear pattern, and therefore people with flat networks or people who think very freely are more suitable in divergent thinking, because our objective will be to generate maximum number of creative ideas. So a person has to find out what type of thinker he is before getting into the act of design thinking. If he is to be a divergent thinker, then he should be able to think creatively and should think of diverse or different solutions without having any predetermined solution in mind. So our mind should not be constrained, it should be let free and should be creative, so that we can generate large number of creative ideas, creative and diverse ideas. Now coming to convergent thinking. So convergent thinking is actually the opposite of divergent thinking. In divergent thinking, our main objective was to generate large number of ideas so that we can choose from these number of ideas. In convergent thinking, what happens is we try to find out which of these generated ideas are workable or feasible, and then we try to concentrate on most workable idea alone. That is known as convergent thinking. Converging means we are trying to focus to a particular point. Again, convergent thinking was also coined by J.P. Guilford or Joy Paul Guilford in 1956. And the concept of convergent thinking is that the design thinker should go through all the possible solutions that were brought about during the divergent thinking. So during divergent thinking, the design team would have generated a large number of ideas. At that point of time, it would not have been checked whether those ideas are workable or not. But during convergent thinking, the thinker or the design thinker should go through all these listed possible solutions or ideas that were generated during the divergent thinking process. He should go through it one by one, and then finally he should come up with a correct solution. All the solutions will not be workable. Some might be workable and some might not work at all. So he should be able to identify which are the workable solutions and then concentrate on the most feasible solution from that different number of solutions. The convergence on a single solution or a mix of a limited number of solutions is the essence of convergent thinking. So in convergent thinking, we may have more than one solution which might be workable. Suppose we have a problem, we generate a large number of ideas. Some ideas are workable, some ideas are not workable. So during convergent thinking process, the design thinker goes through all these ideas and finds that around two or three ideas are really workable. Then he should identify among these three ideas which one idea will be most suitable for the problem, and then focus on that solution. The thinker is supposed to come up with a single, well-established and best possible solution to that problem. So in this way, convergent thinking will ensure that the best solution will be delivered or given for that problem statement. So the divergent thinking and convergent thinking, they usually come together. Divergent thinking will be the first phase and convergent thinking will just follow the divergent thinking phase. Then convergent thinking features is that it requires speed, accuracy, efficiency, logical reasoning and different techniques. So it requires speed because there are a large number of ideas that were listed during divergent thinking. So the design thinker has to go through each and every one of these listed ideas. So that requires speed. Again, it requires accuracy and efficiency, so that the design thinker should correctly identify which are the ideas that are workable and which are not workable. And he should do this in a logical manner. He should use his logical reasoning to check whether at each stage whether the idea is workable or not. And then use different techniques to concentrate on the most feasible solution. He should be able to recognize the patterns and also reapply a few techniques and accumulate and organize the stored information. So, patterns, recognize the patterns means if there are a number of similar ideas, suppose there are 100 number of ideas that are generated. So the design thinker should go through all these 100 ideas listed during the divergent thinking process. It is a very time consuming process. So he should look for ideas which are similar. That means he should be able to identify the similarity. That is the meaning of pattern, recognizing the pattern. So he should be able to identify similar ideas so that he can use lesser time or only less time is spent for going through those ideas. So he should not, or he need not go through all the similar ideas, because they will be almost having a similar nature. So to save time, he can just organize these ideas based on their patterns. Similar patterns, the ideas with similar patterns can be grouped as a single unit so that he can save time. And he should be able to organize all the stored information in the correct manner. So in future, when he needs to refer to all this information, it should be available in a well-organized manner. Now, what are the aspects of convergent thinking? Convergent thinking should help to arrive at a single best answer or a single best solution without any room for ambiguity. So it means that once we try to focus on a single solution for a problem, we should be able to identify that as the single best solution. It should be the best solution from among a number of solutions, and also there should not be any confusion. Ambiguity means there should not be any confusion to finalize on that solution. It should be very clear. The ideas thought of in the process of divergent thinking are either considered to be possible or impossible in convergent thinking. So in divergent thinking, as we mentioned, we just list out a large number of ideas. We don't check whether these ideas are workable or not. Only in convergent thinking, we try to analyze each of these ideas in detail and find out whether they are possible or whether they are not possible to work. And judgment is an important part. So in divergent thinking, there was no need for any judgment, but in convergent thinking, judgment of the design thinker is a must. He should judge, or he should decide whether the particular idea is best suited for the problem or not. So judgment is an integral part. Now, the convergent divergent thinking approach can be shown as a picture like this. So it is called as a double diamond model of design thinking. So double diamond model, the name came because the name originated because of the shape of the diagram. It resembles a diamond. So that is the reason why it was given a double diamond model. So here you can see it clearly. The two different phases, that is divergence and convergence, and both divergence and convergence occur for multiple number of times. So we start with our problem from this point and we trigger the idea generation process. So the divergence takes place, divergence in the sense large number of ideas are generated, and it happens during the empathize phase. So when we studied about design thinking, we studied this phase known as empathizing with the customer. Empathizing means that we think in the viewpoint of the customer. We think of ourselves as the customer, and then we think what are the solutions that we need for this particular problem. So thinking in the shoes of the customer or thinking as a customer is known as empathizing. So during this empathizing stage, we try to generate as much ideas as possible. And once the stage is reached, we try to converge to defining that problem. So we are actually finding out what exactly the problem is and converging to that problem. That occurs during the define phase. So at this point, we have well defined the problem, what is the problem, and we generate a problem statement. Problem statement is nothing but the customer requirements that are listed out in a proper engineering terms. So we gather all the customer information. We try to gather as much information as possible from the customer. That happens during the empathizing phase. So the collection of data from the customer in the maximum possible manner occurs in empathize phase, and that is done by divergence. And then we try to gather or collect all this data together and properly define what exactly the customer requirement is. So we converge to a particular point so that we can properly define what are the customer requirements. When we have properly defined the customer requirements, we formulate a problem statement. After formulating the problem statement, then again the divergence takes place. So in this phase, it happens during the ideation phase. So during the ideation phase, we know that we generate a large number of ideas either by brainstorming or similar group techniques. So we generate a large number of ideas for this particular problem. And then we try to generate a prototype, or we try to build a prototype and then test the prototype to check whether it is the correct solution or not. So as we proceed to the right hand side, we can see that it is trying to converge to a particular solution. And these stages again are iterative in nature, so that once we ideate, we move to prototype, and then the prototype is tested. If it is not functioning correctly, then again we need to ideate it further, again do the prototype process and again test. So this is an iterative process. And once at the stage when the testing is successful, then we move on to the solution stage. So here we are converging to a final solution, and this solution will be the best possible solution. Suppose we are not able to find out a solution even after a number of iterations, then we again go back to the previous stage, where again we have to do the process. Again, we have to repeat this particular processes, that is empathizing and again defining the requirements correctly. If you are not able to find out a solution, then it means that we have not defined our problem correctly. So we need to define it first and then only go to the next stage. So this model is known as the double diamond model of design thinking. So this model shows in detail the convergence and divergence that is occurring during the different phases of design thinking process. Now, to understand this further, let us just look at a case study of a problem. You are given a problem statement here. So I will just explain this problem in a very simple manner. We have a company. The company name is called DT. It is just a name, DT. Now the process of knowledge transfer is a huge problem for the organization. So it means whenever a new employee joins the organization or the company, then there has to be a knowledge transfer to the new employee. That means the new employee has to be given a training so that the employee knows what all things are happening within the company and what all things he has to do or how he has to work within that company. So for that, trainings are given. Now this company wants to eliminate the cost of extra money and investing time for transferring knowledge to its new employees. That is, the company is trying to minimize its training cost and the time that is needed for training new employees. So always the companies, they have a target of reducing the training cost because it is a cost which is not profitable to the company. It is actually a loss. They have to spend on it. So always all the companies have the motive of or the objective of gaining maximum profit. So whenever a company is spending too much on training, they have to spend so much amount on training so that a large portion of their profit is used up for the training purpose. So their margin of profit is decreasing. So that they want to avoid. And the problem statement is knowledge transfer adds to the cost of the company, which means knowledge transfer or in other words, training is adding to the cost of the company. It is not increasing the profit, it is decreasing the profit of the company. Now, what are the different ways to eliminate or reduce the training cost of the company? That is the problem statement. So we have a company. The objective of the company is to reduce the training cost and duration. And what are the ways by which the company can reduce the training cost? That is the problem statement. And by divergent thinking, the design thinking team came up with a large number of ideas which are listed out here. And these ideas can be used, they say that these ideas can be used to reduce the training cost. So let us see what are those ideas. So these ideas, they are a mix of possible and not so possible solution. So this is just the number of ideas are listed out. As we mentioned, in divergent thinking, we do not check whether the ideas are workable or they do not work. We just list out those ideas. So the first one is the company can eliminate process of knowledge transfer. That means they can eliminate the training process. There is no need for giving any training to new employees. Second option is the company can conduct classroom session for the training program where a large number of new employees can be occupied and there will be one instructor to deliver the training program to all those employees. So by using this particular technique, they can reduce the cost of training and also reducing the number of instructors or trainers. The number of trainers required will be less. So training cost can be reduced. Then the next idea was the company came up with a document for knowledge transfer. That is, they developed a document for training. There is a training manual. A training manual is developed. And it can be mailed to every new employee and the employee can go through the document and they can study on their own. So that means self-training, the employee can read out those documents or those training manuals and train himself. Next option was that the company can ask the employees to search for material online to gain knowledge of the new tools and processes which are currently used in the company. So the company is not directly giving any training to the person. The company is asking that person to go and gain knowledge, to go and search the internet and gain knowledge on certain areas which are or which will be useful for his work in that company. Then finally, the last idea developed was that the company can hire only those employees who have adequate know-how of tools and techniques that the company works on. So suppose if the company is working on a particular technology, the company will be hiring or they will be taking only those persons who are already trained well in that area. So by that process, the company will not have to spend additional time and resources for training that person because the person is already trained. So that will eliminate the need for knowledge transfer or training. So these were the different ideas that were developed during the divergent thinking process. So when after divergent thinking, we have to come up with the best solution. So for that, convergent thinking was applied on these all these solutions or all these ideas. So those ideas are listed out in a generic manner here. All these were the ideas that we talked about in this slide. So during convergent thinking, the options that came up or the solutions that came up was that option one is not feasible, that is eliminating the knowledge transfer program or eliminating the training program is not feasible because every employee does not have the idea of company's tools and techniques. So there are new employees and there are old employees in the company. The new employees, if they are not given proper training, then they won't have an idea of the company's working and what all things have to be worked within that company. What are the tools and techniques used by that company? So all these the new employee has to know. So the option one is not workable. Then let us look at the option five, the last option, hiring only those employees who are experienced enough and who don't need knowledge transfer. So again, that is also not acceptable due to the same reason, because every employee, they do not have the idea of every new employee will not have an idea of the company. They have to be trained on that technology and the company's tools. Then coming to the option 4, the employees to search for knowledge resources online. That is, the employee will not be directly given any training. He will be asked to search for online resources on training. So that is not that does not guarantee the speed of learning process, because each employee will have their own pace of learning or speed of learning. Some may learn very quickly, some may take their own time to learn, and the learning time cannot be correctly monitored. So option 4 is also not one of the best option. So that leaves option 2 and option 3. So option 2 and option 3, again, if we cross check on these options and we check whether which of these options are more effective, we can see that the third option, that is preparing a document for training, it is again not the best option, because the document effectiveness of the document cannot be correctly estimated. We cannot know who all are reading those documents, and after reading those documents, we cannot know how much knowledge that particular employee has gained. Some may gain good knowledge, some might not gain knowledge at all. So again, option 3 is also not the best option. So that leaves only one option, that is option 2. That means having a instructor for knowledge transfer program or training program, and the training program is conducted as a classroom session. So that is the best option for the training program, providing training program as a classroom session with only a single trainer. And reducing the number of trainers will lead to less training expenditures and also ensure classroom teaching effectiveness. So thus we finalize the solution to the problem as having a single instructor for the training program, and it should be conducted as a classroom session. So we had a problem statement and we arrived at a solution for that problem statement. So that is the convergent and divergent thinking approach in design thinking. Divergent thinking will generate a large number of ideas, and convergent thinking will try to converge on the best possible solution from among those number of solutions. Now, design thinking in a team environment. So, how the design thinking can happen when working with a team? Design thinking teams, they are multidisciplinary in nature and highly collaborative. That means the design thinking team will have people from all disciplines, all areas of the organization. They will be from different background, where some will be from design, so that means arts, some will be from engineering, some will be from business, some will be from entirely research domain. So it is a multidisciplinary team that forms the design thinking team. That is because the help of all these people will be needed to find out the best solution. Only one person cannot entirely think and bring out the best possible solution for a problem. If it is a multidisciplinary approach or a multidisciplinary team, then the experience from all the backgrounds, all these backgrounds can be brought into that team. The experience from arts or design, experience from engineering, experience from business, research domain. So all these areas can be combined and the effectiveness will be more for such multidisciplinary team. And they jointly apply human-centered strategies to solve the problem. That means they create a human-centered design. They think from the point of view of the customer, how the customer will be or how the customer will be using the product, what will be the different features that should be available in the product, and how the customer is going to use all these features, whether the customer will be satisfied with all these features. So all these aspects are considered in human-centered design. Now, what are the different features of design thinking team? Design thinking teams, they are diverse in nature and they have diverse perspectives. Perspectives means it is a point of view. Point of view of a particular problem. How they view that problem. Since we have a multidisciplinary team, each person will be viewing the problem in a different manner. If we view or if we try to see a problem in only one way, we won't be able to generate creative solutions for that problem. Suppose we see a problem only with one angle or one aspect, then we'll be able to create or we'll be able to think of solutions only in that manner, only in that way. So our area of thinking, the divergence of thinking in that case will be lesser because we are concentrating only on one particular aspect. But on the other hand, if we think about that product in a large number of ways or large number of perspectives, then we can generate a large number of ideas related to each of these perspectives. Perspectives are the way in which we view that problem. So that will help in creating better, or that will help in finding out better solutions to that problem. So a multidisciplinary approach is very helpful to find out better solutions. The design thinking team seek a variety of perspectives outside the team to better understand the customer's needs and preferences. So the team works from within and outside. That means they work as the design team, and also outside the team, they will work as the customer. So they will think of themselves as the customer itself and then try to analyze whether the product is suitable for them. If it is suitable for them, that means if it is suitable for the customer, then slight modifications can be made to increase its user friendliness and functionality. And if the requirements are not satisfied, then they need to do a redesigning process. Then the second feature is that design thinking teams co-design. So co-designing means they do internally as a design, they design internally as a team, as well as externally with customers or end users. So design thinking teams, they will be in collaboration or they will be in constant contact with the internal design team as well as with the customers. They will be frequently interacting with customers to check whether their requirements are being satisfied in the product or not. The design solutions are not just left to designers or other creative types. That means the design of solutions is not the responsibility of the designers alone. All the people in the design thinking team, they take part in the designing phase. That means the designers, engineers, business leads, strategists. So all those people who are involved in the process, they participate in the design thinking team to find out the solution to their problem. Then feedback from customers or end users or throughout the product development cycle is obtained. So constantly this design thinking team has to interact with the customers to see whether at each point of time at each stage the requirements are being correctly followed or not. Then it ensures proper direction, design direction, and the team is producing something genuinely valuable to the users. So when there is a constant interaction with the customer, we can be sure that the final product will be satisfying all the customer requirements and the customer will be really happy using the product. So constant interaction has to be maintained with the customer or the end user regarding the different stages that are happening during the design process. Then the third one is design thinking teams experience radical empathy. It means the design thinking teams, they have to constantly think from the view of the customer. They should understand the customer's requirements correctly. An understanding of customers' goals, needs, and pain points is critical to develop customer-centric solution. That means they should be correctly able to identify the customer's goals, the requirements, needs, and pain points. Mean pain points are those requirements or those functionalities which are lacking in the earlier products that the customers have used. Suppose you are developing a new product, customers have been using an old product and they are constantly annoyed or they are angry with the earlier product because of the absence of certain functionalities. So those are called pain points because the customer is not satisfied at all with those features. Those features which are absent or some features which are present but the customer is not happy with the feature. Those are known as pain points. So we should correctly identify those pain points and try to address these pain points in our solution or in our product. Then institutional knowledge and assumptions, they can often block the understanding of customers. So whenever the organization or the company tries to follow their own rules and regulations and their own pattern in design, so mostly what happens is they forget about the customer requirements completely and they develop their own product. But finally, when the product is released to the market, it is identified that was not the product that actually the customer wanted. The customer wanted an entirely new product, but that product was not designed by the company. Then design thinking teams dedicate resources to speak directly to or observe customers in real world context. So the design thinking teams, they have external resources who speak with the customers every now and then and find out their requirements, whether their requirements are satisfied at each stages, they check whether it is correctly followed. And to observe customers in a real world, they observe customers with the product. Suppose they are developing a prototype, then they observe the customer, how the customer is using the prototype and whether any additional requirements are needed in the final product or not. So in the actual working condition, how the customers are reacting with the product that is observed. Then it helps to understand customers' needs and the environmental factors which affect their behavior and motivations. So it helps to understand what are the customer requirements and also those environmental factors or the surrounding factors. It can be social or economical also. Those factors which affect the behavior of the customer and what are the things that motivate the customer. Then design thinking teams iteratively reframe problems. So once we have defined a problem, then we try to find out the best possible solution to that problem. And the problems in design are not precise. That is the main disadvantage that we encounter. That means we cannot correctly pinpoint that this is the best solution to the problem. What we can do is we can only find out the approximate solution. So while doing this, we may have to go back to the previous stages again and again, because it is an iterative process. So the whole design process is an iterative process. It is repetitive in nature. So we may have to jump back to the previous stages and then again move forward. So it requires constant reframing, because as the design team learns more about the problem by constantly interacting with the customers, then when they learn that some of the requirements are not correctly satisfied, they have to jump back to the previous stage and again address these requirements and then again move forward. So it becomes iterative in nature. Design thinking teams get paint on the walls, because get paint on the walls means they get a very clear idea of what the actual requirement of the customer is. Design thinking teams make ideas tangible. So when the customer has told an idea about a product, there is only a very unclear idea of what the actual solution will be. And it is the job of the design team to correctly focus the problem or the requirement that the customer has specified, that is focused to the final solution. So it makes ideas tangible, or tangible in the sense something which can be felt or seen. So finally, when the product is developed, it is a tangible one. Design thinking teams understand the value of externalizing ideas. Externalizing ideas in the sense discussing the ideas with the customer, not just within the company or within the design team. The whole idea has to be discussed with the customer or the end user as well. Only then the design team or the designers will correctly understand what the actual requirements are. Suppose we have collected the requirements and we start with working the solutions, the design solutions. If we don't properly communicate with the customer, finally the solution what we develop will not be the solution that is actually wanted by the customer. It might be entirely different. So it is important to constantly have an interaction with the customer, so that the customer is having an idea of what is being happening in the organization, and the design team will also have an idea of what actually the customer wants. The goal is to make the ideas concrete with minimal effort as possible. That means once we go on with the different stage, once we proceed with the different stages, as we proceed towards the final solution, we should ensure that the solution should be acceptable to the customer. So that is our main objective. So as we move towards a final solution, we should ensure that there is no much rework and the final solution will be acceptable by the end user or the customer. And illustration of ideas, they help the design team or the design thinking teams to discuss, challenge, test and ultimately align on what is working and what isn't. So when they sit together and they discuss on these ideas that is developed, they will come to know what are the ideas that are workable and the ideas which do not work. So usually they follow a habit of listing out the ideas. When there is a team meeting, they list out all those ideas in their mind so that after discussing on the different ideas, they converge on or they do a convergent thinking during which they focus on workable ideas and they completely neglect the non-workable ideas. The habit of getting paint on the walls facilitates a culture of enlightened trial and error. So when there is a clearer picture on the solution, then the trial and error becomes more easy because we know the final solution will be what the final solution will be, then we can accordingly modify the procedures accordingly. And it empowers teams to build on successful ideas or roll back when something isn't working. So when the design thinking teams try to bring out more clear ideas, then they can be more confident that the ideas will be successful. And even if they find out that the ideas are not going to be successful, they can find it out on a very earlier stage so that they can go back to the previous stage and perform all those processes once again and come back to the final stage. So this will ensure that the best solution will be developed by the design thinking team. So that are the different features that are available or that are the different features that can be listed for a design thinking in a team environment.